This video is sponsored by Control Plane. Previously on CityFast Fresh Deploys with Rust.
We want to store every revision of our application in the database. Huh, there we have it. We have files, we have latest revision, we have revision files. I mean, that's not bad. So here's how it's going to work. We're going to have another workload whose sole job is to accept HTTP requests. So we're going to need an HTTP client. It is supposed to look at the files, and then we can't connect to that. So that's fine. But you know, this is what's nice about types. You can code one end of the thing, and now we're going to code the other end. So we have the client, now we're going to make the server. So what we actually want to do here is listen on port 9000 and then start an AXM server. So again, nobody's saying that any of this is a good idea, but we can do it. And so I'm going to do it. We don't actually want get, we want post. API post. So this JSON thing here is an extractor. And then we don't want to extract a value, we want to extract API request. And we want to return JSON API response. Always. And we're just going to unwrap if we have errors. Also, we need the pool to be available as the state. Very well, and then here we should be able to extract the state. I can feel this is going to be annoying. AXM is a debug handler macro, but I think we need to enable the macros feature. Consumes the request body. And this must be the last argument. Sure. Into make service does not exist. How does that work then? Is with state supposed to be called at the end? Apparently. Cool. So we can print the payload here. Okay, so it got that, so it's working. I don't want to do an N plus one query, but I don't know if SQLX handles arrays. Binding the array directly and using ID equal any. Okay, cool. So first we need to match on the payload because we have three different things to handle. So let's look at our schema again, which is down here. So we have this files table, we have a path and hash thingy. We want to map that to the inner thing clone. That's going to give us a vec of string if we connect it into a vec. And then we want to do a query. It seems right. And then result is vec of string. Oh, string does not implement from row. Yeah. SQLX has a from row thingy to decode from like a query result. Just struct row, derive from row, and path and hash is a string. And now it works. So now we have a bunch of rows, and anything that isn't in those rows is missing. So I think we actually want to do hash sets here. Let's call it present equals rows, going to be the hash set of path and hash, and Copilot can figure it out from here, I think. And then path and hash has to implement like a bunch of traits, partial ek, and hash. And then missing is just going to be the difference between candidates and the one that are present. Now, you're probably wondering, couldn't we simply have Postgres give us the set of missing rows instead of going through that hash set nonsense? And you would be correct, and here's one way to do it. So $1 here is our list of candidates, just an array for now, but then we call the unnest Postgres function, and that gives us sort of a table named candidates with a path and hash column, and then the condition is simply files that do not exist. So where not exists, select one from files, where the path and hash match for the files table and the candidates table, which again is built from this array here. And then we don't need to go through hash sets, we don't need to derive partial egg and egg. I just didn't think of it in the moment, but this is what I would want to deploy to production if I had to. Yeah. All right, cool. So we have handled our first endpoint. We only have like one down, two to go. Okay, it wants to upload 23 files. We're gonna do one query per file. I think that's right. I mean, we can ask Copilot to implement that one as well, if we get a few comments. Oh, we need to generate a revision ID. It wants to make a UID. I want a ULID. This generate ULID string. It's fine. And then latest revision is kind of a weird table. So it's going to be insert or replace into latest revision 1, 2. And then we bind latest yes. And then revision ID is going to be our revision ID. And finally, we can return the revision ID we just made. Oh, it's what you're seeing here is a vec of U8 serialized to JSON. I forgot that we had binary payloads and that using JSON for this is not a good idea. You know what? We can change that. You can do that when you control both ends of an API. You can change that to whatever. And we're going to use postcard for this, because why not? With survey support. And then we're not going to return JSON. We're going to do response equals blah, and we're going to return a response directly. I'm going to unwrap all this from JSON here. Postcards. 2 bytes to vec. Boxed body. And status code is somewhere cool. And the body type is maxim body body. Now we have postcard everywhere, and we need to make sure that our client also uses that. In here, we can't do JSON anymore. And we could make our own helpers, you know, instead of doing this manually. But, you know, we are only calling 3 different endpoints. It's fine. Okay, do we have any JSON left? Yes. Can we just call it bytes? Bytes give you the raw request body, and bytes is axon body bytes. Oh, interesting. So bytes is actually the type from the crate called bytes, but they just implemented from requests on it, which they can do because from request is their own type. I don't say we forgot to use survey bytes. I have no idea if that actually makes a difference with postcard, but I think it has to. Okay, I feel like this one deserves a little more context. So I have an example here of 2 structs. Each have a vec of U8. One is using survey bytes and the other is not. If we run that, we see that the output is the same. The postcard format is very simple in this case. It puts a variable length integer, that's the length of the slice, and then just the raw bytes. So it doesn't make a difference on the output, but it makes a difference on the code path that it takes. So if we debug this, we'll see the first version hits serialize sec, which is a sequence. In the survey data model, there's maps and there's sequences, and sequences can have any type of value inside of them. So this makes a sequence serializer, and then for every item in the sequence, it's calling another method that can serialize any type of value. But if you instead use Surday bytes, then it goes into serialized bytes, and you can see this is much more efficient. It's just pushing the length of the slice and then extending the output with the slice itself. So it's a lot less code to go through. There's a lot fewer structs and calls involved, and that's the difference it makes. But the output is the same. It's compatible. It might not be the same in other formats if you try that with CBOR or what's its name, MessagePack, which are one and the same essentially. You'll notice that one of them is an array of numbers and the other one is bytes, which are different types in MessagePack and CBOR. So that's the difference. That's what I was thinking of, but didn't say out loud because it was late. I was tired. We just do this. No, yeah. That doesn't work. We're just gonna make a struct called uploaded file. And then the vec8 here is going to be with Surday bytes. Oh, default format. This is why it wasn't formatting my REST code, because Dino stole the default formatter setting for all files, not just TypeScript files. Should this derive debug? Maybe not. Maybe manually. Yeah. So far, so good. Syntax error near. Oh, that means that it uploaded everything. Yeah, all files uploaded. That also means that if we go look at dbeaver now, and we go into files, for example, and data, yeah, we can see our files. Look at that. It uploaded everything. And this was really fast, because it's all local. So insert or replace into is not a thing in Postgres. So insert into latest revision values, blah, on conflict, latest. All right, so let's run this one again and that one again. So if we go to latest revision right now, we shouldn't have anything. Revision files should have all, yeah. So it generated a revision ID and then it listed all the files that it should have, but then latest revision should be empty. And it is. But now, if we do that again, yeah, it made a new revision, look at that. So now latest revision, how do we refresh this, F5? Yes, it's this, and then if we go in revision files, should be twice as much data, yes. Ah, this is great. This is great. We only have like a tiny part of this to do. But I do want to deploy this on control plane and actually put that in our production database, which does not exist yet. We still have to set that up. Exciting. We're about to find out if my stupid idea actually works. Of course, I already know. I'm sitting here with the raw footage of everything, but you don't. You're just waiting and wait, unless you're watching this later, in which case you're not waiting, or you're not watching the video at all, in which case, who am I talking to right now?